Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 6572 in the name of Ben McPherson on progress on the automation and take-up of Scottish Social Security benefits. I would invite those members who wish to ask to speak in the debate rather to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Ben McPherson, Minister, to speak to and to move the motion. Up to 12 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and today's debate is regrettably timely because as we head into winter, the unfair and unnecessary reality of 21st century Britain is that for many, for too many, far too many, the cost of living crisis that we are in is so deeply worrying and will be damaging in a multitude of ways. Too many of the constituents we serve are facing very difficult financial decisions that they shouldn't be having to make, and they're facing costs and bills that shouldn't be so high. This shouldn't be happening in one of the wealthiest countries in the world, with more billionaires in the UK than ever before. The situation is wrong. And that is why, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is taking action, including investing £1 billion to support families with financial help and households during this time that is not available elsewhere in the UK. This, of course, includes the Scottish Child Payment, which will shortly increase to £25 per week and be extended to under-16s. And yesterday, the Deputy First Minister also confirmed that we will double the December bridging payment for families to £260 and increase our fuel insecurity fund to £20 million. I acknowledge the action that the UK Government have taken so far, and it is welcome, but also we need them to use the vast amount of levers that they have to do more in this emergency, to tackle the scale of the challenge in a way that's required, including increasing benefits in line with inflation and increasing universal credit by £25, which should also be extended to means-tested legacy benefits. Because in the context of this cost of living crisis, in this unjust context that has undoubtedly been influenced by COVID and international affairs, but has also undoubtedly been exacerbated by 10 years of ideological austerity, the calamity of Brexit and reckless recent UK government economic policy decisions. In this context, the importance of a reliable and responsive social security net has never been more pertinent, and how we use the limited powers and resources of this devolved Parliament, ambitiously but also realistically, where we can to make a meaningful difference, has never been more important. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is clear that social security is an investment in the people of Scotland. Indeed, this is the first of the eight principles in the Social Security Act 2018. It is a shared investment in building a fairer society together. And from promoting devolved Scottish benefits to delivering more accessible application processes, from providing advice and advocacy to taking a more person-centred approach and starting from a position of trust, we are committed to doing what we can to ensure people are aware of what they're entitled to and feel empowered to seek what they're due. And that's why we are working day in, day out to remove barriers, to provide support, to tackle any stigma around applying for benefits, and to get more money out to low-income households, more money out to them than anywhere else in the UK. Presiding Officer, remarkable teams are doing this work out of Social Security Scotland's offices in Dundee and Glasgow. And we are also working in communities across the country, directly with people, using the social security system. As we have successfully implemented Social Security Scotland's local delivery network, with over 400 excellent staff now operational in 32 local authority areas. And in the 4 years since the 2018 Social Security Act was passed, we, this Scottish Government, with highly motivated and extremely capable civil servants, have delivered 12 benefits, 7 of which are completely new forms of financial support only available in Scotland, and our 13th will be introduced in February, called Winter Heating Payment. We are delivering a simplified, easily accessible, compassionate system that treats everyone with dignity, fairness and respect, and a system which 92% of respondents to a client survey have rated their overall experience as very good or good. I'll take the intervention.
Hand on Glancy.
I thank the Minister for taking the intervention, and I welcome the approach that the Minister has outlined to social security in Scotland. But how does that explain the high rates of redeterminations coming back overturning the decision, particularly in child disability payment?
Minister.
I'm not sure what empirical evidence Ms. Pam Duncan-Glancy is citing, but I'm happy to engage with her on that point. Of course, there is a determination on both child disability payment and adult disability payment to get our decisions right first time, but I'm happy to have further engagement on that point. But certainly the situation that she has outlined is not reflective of the situation as I see it, but we can engage on that further in a constructive way. Just to deal with the amendments at this juncture, the Conservative amendment, I've already acknowledged the support of the UK Government, but pushed and encouraged them to do more. Unfortunately, I cannot accept the Conservative amendment because there's a factual inaccuracy in it, in that it states that the Scottish Welfare Fund review has been delayed, which it has not. I will update the committee shortly on this, but I cannot accept that amendment because of this. Unfortunately, I cannot accept the Labour amendment either, because it deletes huge portions of the motion, and also through what all I can see is wishful thinking, seems to state that matters could be done quicker and could have been delivered quicker through the years past. And I say in good faith that since the 2018 Act has been passed, this government has worked with innovation, determination and passion to deliver as quickly as possible, but also as safely and securely as possible, Scottish devolved social security benefits, and we will continue to do that. The motion itself is not party political in the sense that it doesn't criticise and it doesn't talk about the Constitution, so if both amendments are defeated, I would hope that all parties can support the motion and we can take a united approach. Because, Presiding Officer, this Government is working proactively with determination to support people who are eligible for assistance and to help them to access and take up the benefits to which they are entitled. For example, information about Scottish Social Security benefits is featured as part of our new cost of living campaign, which directs people to our new one-stop shop website that was launched in September. And moreover, Social Security Scotland has delivered 12 paid-for marketing campaigns since October 2021, covering a range of online and offline channels, including TV, radio, print, digital and out-of-home advertising. And of course, we will continue to work with stakeholders to ensure information about each of the Scottish benefits is available in places where our target audiences already are, so that it's accessible as possible. For example, 43,000 leaflets covering the five family payments and more recently the child disability payment are included in the Scottish Government's baby box and in NHS midwife and health visitor packs. We are also providing materials to DWP work coaches and job centres to encourage young people to apply for the job start payment. And we have partnered with supermarket retailer Asda and worked with Iceland, ScotMid and the Co-op to make sure that information about our benefits reaches people where they are. And information about our benefits is also included in refugee welcome packs. And fact sheets are proactively translated into community languages like Ukrainian in particular this year. And of course, in January, we launched our free and independent Social Security Advocacy Service to support disabled people to access and apply for Scottish Social Security benefits. And we have also continued to invest in providing advice and accessible settings to maximise incomes and tackle poverty. Quickly, please.
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm glad to Mr. Just in regard to that clarification, I'm unsure, maybe it's my ignorance, but I'm unsure where within my region these advisers sit. Would it be possible for at least MSPs and maybe local councillors to be given that information? Because I certainly am not aware of where it happens within Lothian.
Minister.
Social Security Scotland has been proactive with MPs and MSPs about reaching out to raise awareness of the services available. Indeed, Pam Duncan-Glancy met with her local delivery team just recently. But certainly, I can take that point away to following this debate to write out to members again with sources of information so that all of us can play a role in spreading the word, because you know we're doing it in GP practices, it's happening across Scotland as I've set out, and all of this is helping with take-up rates. And is being done to drive take-up of benefits. And our latest estimates of take-up for benefits were published on Monday, and this is been a very helpful publication. It is estimates, and it's difficult to analyse, but it will help give us a benchmark in order to continue to track where we are. Our most recent estimate take-up rates are reassuring on the whole, showing really encouraging figures for our Scottish Child Payment and Best Start suite of payments in particular. We're not quite where we want to be with funeral support payment and Job Start payment. However, we're working proactively to make a difference there. Presiding Officer, automation is one of the key tools available to us in driving up the take-up of benefits. And automation of processes and payments across the social security system is an area that we're working proactively in to remove barriers to access. We have already automated the carers allowance and child winter heating assistance. And if Parliament agrees next week, we will also pay the Best Start early learning and Best Start school age payments automatically to eligible individuals who are in receipt of Scottish Child Payment from the 28th of November. So there's more to do in that area, and I'm sure we'll discuss it today, but we're already making good progress. It would be inappropriate for me, Presiding Officer, not to outline in this debate at the beginning important ways in which we seek to maximise the take-up of Scottish benefits without referencing resourcing and the financial uncertainty that we're in. Social Security expenditure is needs-based and demand-led, and as such is determined by the number of people who are in receipt of benefits. And it's important to acknowledge that after benefit take-up has taken place, any shortfall between actual expenditure and the Social Security block grant adjustment will need to be covered by funding by the Scottish Government in line with the principles and policies set out in the mid-term financial strategy. But we are absolutely committed and resolute in our conviction that this spend is important, as it's an investment in the people of Scotland and about putting our principles into practice. We have a finite budget, one that is already worth £1.7 billion less than it was in December due to inflationary pressures and UK government actions. But every decision we make in social security that needs additional investment must come from that fixed budget, as the constraints of devolution mean that we cannot borrow to meet increased costs. But we are absolutely committed to promoting and encouraging people to access benefits and the support which they are entitled to, because it's the right thing to do. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, the collective challenge our constituents face underlines the need for us to work together to help, support and empower people to access assistance that they're entitled to, both Scottish support and UK government support, such as universal credit and pension credit. And so I wish to emphasise that if we all need to encourage people to access Social Security Scotland, and that when they do so, they will always be treated with dignity, fairness and respect. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Minister. And before I call the next speaker, could I remind all those members who wish to speak in the debate to ensure that their request to speak buttons are in fact pressed. Thank you. I now call on Jeremy Balfour to speak to and move Amendment 6572.1. Up to 8 minutes, please, Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm happy to be speaking in this debate today and to move a Conservative amendment in my name. It's an amendment that I hope can unite us in this chamber in recognising the work that both the Scottish Government are doing to help people during the cost of living crisis. Because that is what this country needs at this moment in history. It needs both our governments to work together to alleviate the stress that is being placed on families. The benefit of devolution is that alongside national measures that are enacted UK-wide, we can also provide targeted local support here in Scotland. And our amendment reflects this, acknowledging that there is a positive working relationship between the Department of Work and Pensions and the Scottish Government. And I want to give credit to the Minister for engaging constructively with the DWP to ensure that claimants in Scotland have seen minimal disruption during the transfer to Social Security Scotland. However, I'm afraid that is where the credit for this Scottish Government runs dry, because the transfer of benefits to a devolved agency has been far from smooth. Late and over budget doesn't even begin to describe the extent to which the SNP have struggled to take control of benefits in Scotland in a second. The handover won't be completed until at least 2025, meaning that a project that was projected to take 4 years will have taken almost a decade. The admin cost of Social Security Scotland has quadrupled from £36 million in 2019-20 to a staggering £130 million in 21-22. I'm happy to take the intervention.
Minister.
I thank the member for taking the intervention. Does the member recognise that increases in cost have been because we are delivering more than was envisaged when we passed the 2018 Act, in that we are delivering 7 benefits that are not available elsewhere in the UK? And does the member acknowledge that both the Department for Work and Pensions and the Scottish Government made a collective decision to pause the delivery of some of our benefits because of the need for reprioritisation during the pandemic? This is a joint exercise between the UK Government and the Scottish Government, so any criticism on delay should be targeted at both governments if it's going to have any validity.
Jeremy Balfour.
I think the Minister actually misses the point. This would have been delayed even without COVID. These delays were already in place before COVID hit, and that was all to do with the Scottish Government, nothing to do with DWP. But add to the fact that the Scottish Government's soft support assessment has cost Social Security Scotland over £64 million in fraud and error over the last year alone, and we find ourselves staring at a complete mess. Thankfully, the broad shoulders of the UK Government have been able to pick up the slack led by this SNP mismanagement. Thanks to the steady hands of DWP, claimants have experienced minimal disruption and money continues to get into the hands of those who need it. It's worth noting at this point that if the Scottish Government had their way and had broken up the UK, the people of Scotland would lose this vital support. It would be on its own to muddle through the difficulties of setting up a social security system for an entire nation, and we haven't been able to do a few benefits. I'm afraid my time's running short. The truth is, Presiding Officer, as much as this SNP government might like to deflect from their own record by complaining about big bad Westminster, the DWP is taking action to ensure that the people of Scotland are supported through this difficult period. No, I'm afraid I don't have time. They are providing the £650 cost of living payment for every household on means-tested benefits, meaning that over 8 million of the most vulnerable UK... Do I get the time back, President Officer?
You could get a wee bit of time back, yes.
If, to stop Bob, yes.
Bob?
I thank the member for giving way. The member keeps talking about the broad shoulders of the UK. Can I ask the member if he believes the broad shoulders of the UK should uprate all benefits in line with inflation so that people living in poverty aren't suffering at the hands of the broad shoulders of the UK?
Jeremy Balfour.
Yes, I do.
Good.
I do believe that. And so let me continue. Over 8 million of the most vulnerable UK households will be directly sent a one-off cash payment for £650. They have increased the winter fuel payment to £300 in addition to sending all existing recipients an additional one-off £300 cash payment, helping families to heat their homes this winter. Not another delay by the Scottish Government for another year. An extra £150 disability cost of living payment for those in receipt of disability benefits provides support for the most vulnerable in our society. For those on disability benefits such as DLA and PIP, a £150 boost will provide much needed supplementary funds. This is all in addition to the £400 cash grant to every household to help with energy costs over the next 6 months. Presiding Officer, this is in contrast to the soaring rhetoric of the SNP Government that never seems to live up to the hype. We get huge promises to grab headlines and fuel conference speeches, and almost immediately it comes down and fails. For this reason, Presiding Officer, we on these benches are sceptical of the Government's ability to deliver on their plans. I'd be interested to hear from a Minister about the number of welfare right advisers that are in place across Scotland, and actually how many GP practices today have somebody in place rather than something that will happen in the future. I'm happy to give way if you'd like to tell me.
Minister.
Thank Jeremy Balfour for the paragraph that I had to cut from time, but the investment that we are making takes our total commitment to 3.5 million over 3 years and places welfare rights advisers in up to 180 GP practices in Scotland's most deprived areas.
Jeremy Balfour.
Again, the Minister fails to answer the question. How many are in place today? Not in the future, but today. And yet again, another delay and another failing. The Scottish Welfare Fund, and I would be genuinely interested if the Minister can tell us, if it is not delayed, will he give a guarantee that we will see that report on the due date? And perhaps he could cover that in his closing off, rather than keep saying he's going to write to the committee. Presiding officer, to round up, we on these benches support both of Scotland's governments in efforts to ensure that support makes it to those who need us quickly and seamlessly as possible. But the promises must be matched with action. People don't need kind words about future plans. They need real action right now. Thank you, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. And I now call on Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to and move Amendment 6572.2. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. In the midst of the current cost of living crisis, people are struggling more than ever. We need a social security system that meets that challenge. It is crucial that it is fit for purpose and is able to catch people when they need help. Social security exists to provide that safety net. But safety nets are no use if there are holes in them. There should be no one entitled to benefit in Scotland that does not yet receive it. Sadly, there are too many people in that position. Nearly 30% of young carers don't get the grant they're entitled to, and over 30% of people who are eligible don't get funeral support payments. And there are other examples. The easiest way to sort this is obviously to automate payments, and so I welcome moves from the government to do so. But I am again frustrated at the pace of and ambition for change on this. We should really be striving for a system that is smart enough to identify incomes, recognises when people become eligible for benefits and can then pay out. Instead, what we have is something that is piecemeal, staggered and disconnected. We really need to address this because automation would not just ensure people don't miss out on the money they're entitled to, it would remove the burden of having to hunt down support in times of crisis. Part of the problem, though, is that right now we don't have a system that is fully administered in Scotland, never mind fully automated. There is still no timetable for the development and delivery of many of the devolved benefits, the replacement for attendance allowance, carers' additional person payment, severe disablement allowance or employment injury assistance. We are still waiting the government's plans for a replacement carers' allowance too, and in the meantime, thousands of carers are falling through the net, not receiving anything for the care that they do. Disabled people, I will.
Emma Roddick.
For taking the intervention. I appreciate the point she's making around pace, and she'll know that I share the want to get money into people's hands as soon as possible, but she must appreciate that it would be easier for a system to take into consideration incomes if income-based benefits were also devolved. Does she support the overall devolution of the full social security system so that we don't have to keep asking the DWP for this data?
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, and I thank the member for that intervention. And the member will know that I have said time and again that I think this is about planning and proper cooperation between both governments so that we get the data we need and can deliver the benefits that we have to. Disabled people, carers, older people and women have been left in DWP-administered system that is widely recognised as unfit for purpose. Now more than ever, as people are struggling to heat their homes and put food on the table, they need the government to take responsibility for the powers they hold. Stop leaving them in Tory hands. The simple fact is they're not doing this. The system is failing to meet people's needs, and I worry that in its current form it will never be able to deliver the sort of vision that Scottish Labour have, where inequality is a thing of the past, where everyone has enough money to live on, can enjoy the right to work and have access to a social security system that is adequate, automated, based on human rights and there when you need it. The reality is we're nowhere near achieving that vision, and I don't think we're even on the path to it. I acknowledge that some work has been impacted by the pandemic, but that doesn't explain all the delays, nor does it excuse the fact that the government has failed to make any progress at all on so many benefits that it has power over. Instead, it's handed those back to the DWP, and it's spending huge swathes of cash doing so. Half the benefits we should have control over are still administered elsewhere. It's disappointing. Take adult disability payment, for example. The SNP could have made real changes by removing the 20-metre rule and the 50% rule, recognising that these are arbitrary numbers, allowing for no recognition of fluctuating conditions. They've said that they must prioritise safe and secure transfer first, but they promised disabled people radical change 7 years ago. They are getting tired of waiting. I'm frustrated that it's taken years for all eligible kids to get Scottish Child Payment and the uptake is still not what it should be. And I'm frustrated that when the SNP were challenged on this, they wouldn't accept responsibility for not planning on it, instead saying the UK government didn't give the data to them. But the then Secretary of State confirmed in committee that they hadn't asked for it. There are countless ways I could criticise the DWP, and if I had more time I would, but they can't be blamed for not giving the Scottish Government data they didn't ask for. In the same vein, I understand that DWP data sharing is also one of the barriers to automating local authority administered benefits. As it stands, local authorities do have access to real-time income data from the DWP in order to access eligibility for council tax reduction, but this data has been shared with the explicit agreement that it must only be used for that purpose, meaning it cannot be used to reach out to those who should be eligible for Best Start grants, school uniform grants or free school meals. One way around this would, of course, be to level eligibility. I will.
Co-Cab Stewart.
Pam Duncan, would you welcome that by the end of this month, eligible families in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment will receive the Best Start Grant Early Learning Payment and the Best Start School Age Prepayment without the need to apply?
I thank the member for that intervention, and as I said in the earlier part of my speech, about 30% of those young people don't get that, so yes, I do welcome it. I do welcome it. We really need both governments to start working together and delivering for the people of Scotland instead of pointing fingers or in the case of the Tories, sitting on their hands. We cannot understate the opportunity we had to create a whole new system from the bottom up. It was a key moment, and it feels increasingly like the SNP failed to meet it. Can I get my time back, please, Deputy President Officer? Thank you. Yes.
Minister.
I just wonder if, in amongst her, I believe, unfriended criticisms on timelines, Ms Duncan Glancy would like to acknowledge that the only reason that we have powers over social security in this Parliament is because of the SNP, and in fact it was her party along with colleagues who opposed more powers for the Scottish Parliament in years past.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
I think the Minister is somewhat rewriting history in that statement. We cannot underestimate the opportunity that we had. It was a key moment, and it feels increasingly like the SNP has failed to meet that. Not just but in some areas, and I say this whilst I also recognise areas where they've improved, the situation in some places has regressed. There is little good about the DWP, but some of the things they do get right seem to be the areas in which the Scottish Government have decided to diverge. So, for example, Social Security Scotland, unlike DWP, refused to accept signed mandates via email, something I discovered because it created barriers for one of my constituents. Last week, it was confirmed to my committee that there are currently no referral pathways in place at Social Security Scotland, allowing direct referrals from agencies such as schools or GPs. That is a huge missed opportunity and a problem the Government must urgently seek to address. Low uptake could easily be addressed by automation, but it could also be addressed by proper referral mechanisms. And focusing on fancy comms and social media puts the burden on the person to apply. It's expensive and isn't really leading to enough uptake. So the Government should instead, I think, be investing in people, intensive referral mechanisms and smart IT that can automate payments, identify minimum standards and recognise when people fall below it. Lastly, Deputy Presiding Officer, if we look at the figures on redetermination requests, it's clear that Social Security Scotland is not getting the decision-making right. For some benefits, well over half of these are approved, meaning the system has forced people through additional hurdles when they should have been awarded payments in the first place. This isn't the system we were promised, with redetermination rates like that, it's not the system the SNP have told us they're delivering. There's still time to fix this, and there are still opportunities that lie ahead and the benefits the SNP have not yet started to work on. But things need to change, and they need to do so quickly. For that to happen, the Government must be laser-focused on delivering the social security system it promised.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Clancy. Could I... Point of order, Jeremy Balfour.
Apologies, President Officer. I should have said at the start of my speech, I have referred people to my members of interest, where I am receipt of PIP and hopefully adult disability living allowance at some point.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. That is now on the record. Point of order, Pam Duncan Glancy.
I'm also in receipt of PIP and I refer members to my register of interest too.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Glancy. That is also on the record. I now call on Beatrice Wishart. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms Wishart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Scottish Liberal Democrats have tried to work constructively with the Scottish Government on its welfare responsibilities, and we will continue to do so. And we will remain constructively critical where improvement is needed. In April, my colleague Willie Rennie highlighted the Scottish Government's decision to continue disability benefits under DWP administration, leaving recipients of the Adult Disability Payment Daily Living Component Enhanced Rate worse off by £135.20 per year than they would have been. Being too slow off the mark to use the full extent of the powers the Scottish Government has under devolution is a failure for benefit recipients across Scotland. Scottish Liberal Democrats support a welfare system based on dignity, fairness and respect, and I echo the sentiment that there should not be any stigma around accessing benefits for people entitled to them. Simplifying and automating benefits payments is welcome, and it helps break down stigma that unhelpfully surrounds benefit uptake for those entitled. But extending automation to the Best Start grant early learning and school age payments could have been done sooner. The motion expressly states that the Best Start grant early learning and school age payments will be automated by the end of November 2022, this month. And I'm sure this will be welcomed by families across Scotland, as I welcome it, but they could have benefited sooner. The cost of living crisis will be getting tougher as we enter the winter, and our usual cold weather, along with eye-watering energy bills. The UK government is warming us up to tighter budgets from tax rises and public spending cuts. Every penny in household budgets really will be stretched and relied on heavily this winter. And I welcome the launch of an independent advocacy service and welfare rights advisers to be placed in up to 180 general practitioner surgeries in Scotland's most deprived areas as well as rural areas. There should be an effective publicity campaign to make sure people are aware of this service. I was going to ask the Minister to provide information on the plans to publicise this, but I note what he said earlier. And leaflets are fine, but will there be a national advertising campaign, and in what form might that take? This service and the welfare rights advisers will be a valuable resource for communities across the country. And too often there's simply not enough known about what is available for those on restricted budgets. Online information can be interpreted differently, and this can convince people that they can't apply for a benefit, when actually the opposite is true and they are eligible. Our rural areas are often home to some of the most deprived communities, and so any innovation to break this should be commended for its intent. However, I would like to put on record my concerns that this resource could be slowly eroded with public service cuts, putting the enormous burden back on our fantastic and valuable Citizens Advice Bureau across the country. Citizens Advice Services make representations for people across Scotland, helping them with benefit queries, housing issues, energy costs and much more. The Deputy First Minister outlined adjustments to the Scottish Government's budget yesterday, and we'll now see slower growth in the mental health budget provision. And this will impact on some of the most vulnerable in our society. There will always be more work to do to improve the take-up of entitlements. Work will need to continue to ensure that estimates of the number of people eligible are as accurate as possible, and that accurate uptake figures are generated. These figures and the reasons behind them will need to be continually updated and analysed to ensure that all those who are eligible for a benefit are receiving their full entitlement. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Swisher. We now move to the open debate. I would advise colleagues that we have pretty much exhausted any time we had in hand, so any interventions will need to be accommodated in your speaking time allowance. And with that, I call Natalie Dawn to be followed by Sharon Dowie for up to 6 minutes. Ms Dawn.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The motion before us that we're debating today is truly a positive one, and I continue to be proud of the social security system that we are building here in Scotland. We've built a system that is kind, fairer and more progressive than anything we've seen before. A system that does not treat social security as a burden on the state, but that actively encourages people to take exactly what they are entitled to. I wholeheartedly believe that social security is a significant investment in the people of Scotland. Let's imagine for a minute that the benefit powers that have been devolved were still under the DWP system. There would be no Scottish Child Payment for a start. Many families, children and people with disabilities all across Scotland would still be stuck under the degrading, stale and discriminatory DWP system. I'm actually really disappointed with the amendments that we have in front of us today. While there's always more to do and scrutiny is absolutely essential, it would be really easy to sit in the opposition benches and cast negativity and doubt upon every positive move that this government makes to improve people's lives. Yes, I will.
Carol Mochan.
Thank you for taking the intervention. I think it's interesting that you start off speaking about the fact that you wish people weren't in the system of the DWP, which is so incompassionate, and then can't understand why members on this side want to push the government to do as much as they can to get the systems in place as quickly as possible. So I wonder if you could just acknowledge
through
that
the
point.
Chair, please, Ms Mochan. Natalie Dawn.
I thank the member for that intervention. I actually never said that I can't understand why you're pushing us to do more. I actually did say there is always more to do. I just find that the negativity that comes from the opposition benches is often overlooks the really positive steps that the government are making. So I want to move on to what is an important point in line with the Scottish Fiscal Commission forecasts. The Scottish Government is committing £4.2 billion in benefit expenditure this year, forecast to rise to £6.5 billion in 2026-27. To put that into perspective, that is more than £460 million above the level of funding forecast to be received from the UK Government in 2022-23, and it's then anticipated this will increase to £1.3 billion by 2026-27, still a massive shortfall. And I think these figures show the divergence between the Scottish and the UK governments. We're investing in our people, meanwhile the Tories are doing everything they can to put people off benefits. Rishi Sunak burying his head in the sand when it comes to raising benefits in line with inflation, scraping up every... Yes, I will, thanks.
I'm grateful Miles for Briggs. The member for taking this intervention. And at Social Justice Committee, we have heard again and again the fact that in Scotland, this SNP Green government currently has a £760 million black hole in future welfare policy payments by the end of this Parliament. Where will that money come from, and why do you think the Finance Secretary didn't touch upon that in the two statements he's made to Parliament?
Again, through the chair, Natalie Dawn.
Well, I think the figures that I was relating to relate up to 26-27, and I believe that we will be a flourishing, independent country by that point, so I think we'll have much more freedom on where to allocate our resources. No, I'm not going to take any more interventions. I'd like to make progress, thank you. So scraping up every penny that they can from those that actually need it. It's actually shocking that a Conservative would even stand here in this Parliament and defend the crooks that are running things down in Westminster. Automation is an incredibly positive thing. Filling out form after form after form is trying, degrading and demoralising. So a system that works to simplify that is only going to help people. And I think that's one of the key points that sets this government apart from the catastrophic DWP system. We recognise that there's still work to do to deliver the automation that we want to see. And that's why we're investing over £20 million over the next 4 years on the Social Security Independent Advocacy Service. This will ensure that people looking to claim what they are entitled to are given the support they require in order to do so. Encouraging take-up, making it easier for people to get what they're entitled to, it all works towards reducing the stigma that exists around benefits. Stigma has been identified as one of the key barriers to the take-up of benefits, and the only way to reduce that within the system is to design it with input from the people who use it. Stigma exists within the system. No, sorry, Jeremy, I really need to make progress. Stigma exists within the system because it has been bred through it. I remember attending the job centre making my claim for what at the time was Job Seekers Allowance and honestly feeling like a piece of dirt that someone had just scraped off their shoe. As a young teenager who left home under difficult circumstances, I needed support, not judgment, and it was not there. So I'm so happy that our social security system is taking a different route, and evidence from claimants and people who have used the systems show a clear contrast in the way that people are treated. Not everyone can work, and that can be for a variety of different reasons. Not everyone can work full-time, not everyone can work regular hours, and over and above that, a person's circumstances can change at any point in life, which is why it is key that we have a robust and compassionate social security system in place to protect our citizens. So let's get down to the real issue here, because we can highlight the positive steps the Scottish Government are taking all day long with just 15% of welfare powers. Whilst the Scottish Government is actively encouraging benefit take-up and investing in social security, the UK Government welfare policies are deliberately penalising those that need it the most in our society. It's notable the UK Government does not have its own comparable benefit take-up strategy, but not only is the UK Government shirking on its moral responsibilities to encourage benefit take-up, their welfare policies are actively harming people, causing poverty, destitution and hunger. It's actually embarrassing listening to members speak about the broad shoulders of the UK Government when that Government has imposed the two-child limit, the benefit cap, the removal of the £20 uplift and the continuation of the bedroom tax, which are just some of the aspects of the UK benefit system that have deliberately hurt people. Only with independence can we ensure that we have all the economic levers at our disposal to protect our social security budget from the absolute car crash that the Tories have made of our economy.
You need to wind up now, Ms.
And to protect ourselves from red Tories in the Labour branch office that bow to their masters down in London and will indeed overlook Scotland like they already have done for decades.
Ms. Dawn, I would ask you to resume your seat. I now call Shannon Dowie to be followed by Emma Roberts.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Social security in Scotland is undergoing its biggest transformation in generations. With this comes many opportunities, but the journey is also not without its challenges. The system's success is essential for the well-being of hundreds of thousands of our fellow Scots, and it is in the interest of all parties in this chamber to support the system where appropriate. As a member of the Public Audit Committee, the Section 23 report about the progress of implementing the devolved benefits was one of the few positive reports that the committee has discussed over the past few months. The Auditor General noted that the implementation of the new social security powers was going well. However, he drew the committee's attention to substantial risks that remain unaddressed. To look at the positives, Presiding Officer, Social Security Scotland now administers 12 benefits. As mentioned in the motion, we are now seeing automation of some of those benefits, which is a welcome development. The child winter heating assistance is paid automatically based on entitlement, and the carers' allowance supplement payments are made automatically. In addition, by the end of the year, the Scottish Government are aiming to award the Best Start Grant, Early Learning Payment and School Age Payment automatically to eligible families in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment, and this is welcome news. But as I mentioned, new systems face challenges, and Social Security Scotland is not immune to those. When giving evidence to the Public Audit Committee, the Auditor General highlighted three substantial remaining risks, including assessing relevant data, putting in place longer-term digital solutions, and getting operational staff in place. He went on to say that managing those effectively will be crucial. So I would like to use some of my time today to focus specifically on the issue of data collection and measuring outcomes. Lack of data is a problem that has been highlighted in numerous Audit Scotland reports. I believe we can all agree across the Chamber that without data, it is near impossible to determine whether solutions are cost-effective and are achieving the desired outcomes. And it is the outcomes that we need to be looking at. Otherwise, it's like throwing money into the fire, and those we are trying to help see no long-term benefit. As it stands, the baseline data is there to tell us how many of those entitled are claiming it, but it does not go much further than that. For example, less than one-third of eligible Scots took up the JobStart payment. This is the lowest estimated take-up rate for any Scottish benefit. Only 73% of those estimated to be eligible for the Young Carer Grant claimed it in 2021-22, while only 66% of eligible Scots received the funeral support payment. But why? The truth is, we don't know. We need to find out why. What is stopping or preventing people from applying? We need to find out what the barriers are and remove them. We need to speak to people on the ground and find out what's happening. But more importantly, we need to listen and we need to take action. And I did note in the Minister's speech about the actions that he has taken and is going to write out to us, which would be appreciated. Poor data collection and evaluation are persistent problems that the Government regularly runs into. One policy area that has been negatively impacted by the absence of sufficient data collection and evaluation is tackling child poverty. As highlighted in Audit Scotland's Tackling Child Poverty report, it is abundantly clear that a crucial barrier to developing sufficiently targeted policies is the absence of children and families with lived experience of poverty in the policy development stage. And again, that is something that I've noted in various topics in various reports. We need to spend more time in the policy development stage, work out what it is we want to achieve, listen to stakeholders, and put in timescales, targets and measurements for outcomes. Presiding Officer, we should be using every tool at our disposal to understand why there is only partial uptake of some benefits and whether it is even delivering the desired outcomes. A system that does not listen to the people it sets out to help is simply unsustainable. It requires two-way communication. In fact, a key recommendation of the Tackling Child Poverty report includes working with stakeholders such as the local government, the third sector, COSLA and those with lived experience of poverty to set out how actions will be delivered, monitored and how their impact is evaluated. In closing, Presiding Officer, I would like to reiterate that no matter how much or how little progress has been made, if the Scottish Government truly wants to build a system that works for Scotland, then the data must capture a detailed picture of its workings, its impact with stakeholder involvement weaved throughout its operation. Given the ever-changing nature of the external environment, the system must be flexible, it must be adaptable to change, and it must be done with the input of stakeholders. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Dowie. I now call Emma Roddick to be followed by Polly McNeill for up to 6 minutes. Ms Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I understand this is not a registrable interest, but in the interest of transparency and as other colleagues have indicated the same, I am now in receipt of adult disability payment. I've been really happy to see the efforts made by the Scottish Government to make applying for and receiving new Scottish benefits as easy and accessible as possible. Just last week, I noticed a sponsored column in my local newspaper, the Inverness Courier, directing people to the Scottish Government's cost of living support page, gov.scot/cost of living support. And the next morning, a fancy online graphic popped up, sponsored onto my Facebook home feed, promoting the same. And it was great to hear the Minister talk earlier about the translation efforts and the leaflet campaigning that's going on as well. Effort and money are being put in by the Government not to gatekeep and confuse, but actually to reach out to people and make them aware of what they might be entitled to. Ensuring people can access the support that they need is a moral and legal duty, so it shouldn't be surprising or refreshing that this is happening. But to those of us with experience of trying to deal with the DWP, it really, really is. Visiting the headquarters in Dundee remains a highlight of my time as an MSP so far. And on Jeremy Balfour's earlier point around regional delivery, following round robins from the Minister and the agency, I've been in touch with the relationship lead for Shetland, Orkney, Murray and the Highlands. And I'm looking forward to my visit to the local delivery team in Inverness later this month. I encourage MSPs of every party to make sure that they are doing all they can to get information about the Scottish support to their constituents. And I think it's right that today's motion focuses on progress. It means that we can recognise we've come a long way and also that there's more to come. Nobody's claiming that the system is now complete and as good as it will ever be. So I have a lot of sympathy with Labour and my colleague Pam Duncan-Glancy's asks, and I'm sure they are being put forward in good faith. But I do think we have to recognise that going too fast risks the safe and secure takeover that the Scottish Government has prioritised. Automation is complex, and I don't think it's unreasonable to acknowledge that complexity and for the Scottish Government to ensure that it is getting things right the first time. The progress on automation has been impressive and welcome. Carers allowance supplement is automatically given to those receiving carers allowance. Child winter heating assistance is automatically paid to those with qualifying benefits. That payments of the Best Start grant, early learning and school age payments will be added to this list of automatic payments by the end of this month is extremely welcome news. And there seems to be extremely welcome news just about every day at the moment. Doubling the Fuel Insecurity Fund, doubling the Children's Bridging Payment and £1.4 million for islanders with higher energy costs, which will mean so much to so many in my region. These new systems being built by Social Security Scotland are fantastic, a world away from Whitehall's computer says no attitude and claims that payments can't be increased because of limitations in the software. What does hold us back, though, are the very limited fiscal powers in place here. If we cannot borrow and we cannot overspend, we cannot react to crises. Whatever we do with the 30%-ish of social security powers we have here, our constituents are still subject to the humiliating and degrading treatment if they need universal credit or another benefit still administered by the DWP. This punitive approach does absolutely no good in tackling the massive stigma that still exists around social security. And that's something we have to keep in mind here. Even those who are entitled to help and getting some may not be comfortable seeking out further help. Regardless of how well automated the system is, tackling the stigma will still be a worthwhile endeavour. To automate top-ups, people still have to be in receipt of the passporting benefit. We need to get to a place where nobody is ashamed or afraid to ask for basic help. It's interesting that the Tories have focused on data collection in their amendment, and I wonder if their members think that it's okay that the DWP repeatedly refuses to publish the data that it collects. A committee in Westminster actually had to use special powers to publish a DWP report on disabled people's experience of its benefit system. We can't compare the over 90% satisfaction rate of clients of Social Security Scotland with the DWPs because they haven't published those figures in years. The Tories do not have a better strategy for social security. They don't have a strategy at all beyond criticising the Scottish Government. While the SNP focused on increasing benefit uptake, the Tory government down south... Yes, I will.
Miles Briggs.
Grateful. She says that the Conservatives are criticising. She will be fully aware of the Social Justice Committee, which we are both members of, and the Finance Committee are raising these very concerns with ministers. So I think that's important to put that on the record.
Emma Roddick.
I think there are ways to raise concerns, and the Social Security Committee does great work, I think, as one of its members in scrutinising, but I do think the hypocrisy in the amendment was worth pointing out. The Tory government down south has decided to increase the threshold that people actively have to search for work in before being sanctioned. They focused on taking benefits away during a cost of living crisis for those with the least. And CPAG told the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, "We have evidence that strict conditionality does not help people to find better jobs, better paid jobs, or more hours. In fact, poverty in itself is a barrier to people being employed." So not only is the approach down south cruel, it's ineffective. It does not work. So much so that the DWP, again, won't publish data on just how bad it is. Which is why, although both governments working together is necessary in this setup, we cannot put politics aside. Political ideology is what determines whether a person or a party believes in spending money or not, prioritises people helping people or funnelling money to those who already have more than they can use, moves money around in the budget to increase the Scottish child payment or to increase bankers' bonuses. Politics matters. It's all of our jobs. We cannot leave politics at the door to discuss social security because my idea of what a social
you need
security
to wind
system
up now, Ms. Roddick.
Would look like with dignity, fairness and respect at its heart is extremely different to that of the Tories. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Roddick. I am sorry, particularly for those that are taking interventions, to still keep you to your 6 minutes, but we do have no time in hand. With that, I call Polly McNeill to be followed by Paul McLennan. Up to 6 minutes, Ms. McNeill.
Thank you. With more than 1 in 10 not claiming child benefit, child payment, 1 in 3 not applying for funeral support, which is quite concerning, and only 29% claiming job support, we can see that we've got a huge job to do to make sure that people claim the benefits they're eligible for. I'm sure we'll agree on that. During my time as Deputy Convener of the Social Security Committee, I recognised that many families entitled to vital financial support they were not claiming, and at the time I championed that for that reason. In fact, I'm sure the members opposite will give Scottish Labour some credit for the work that we did in the early years of the creation of the social security system. We also championed a social security system in Scotland that was fit for purpose. And on that, and the SNP, and even some of the Conservative members, we were at one. And Mark Griffin put essential elements into the Act, which were really, really important. And some of the things I want to talk about myself, about the importance of automating social security benefits. I moved a Labour amendment to the Child Poverty Act in 2017, supporting local authorities and asking them to consider the automatic payment of benefits and to support that. And also a duty on the Social Security Agency, which I've not heard much about, that on application of one benefit, the Social Security Agency in Scotland has a duty to check if you have other benefits. Now, these are the kind of distinguishing things in the Scottish system that are meant to set it apart from the Westminster system. So I think we need to see evidence that this is actually being used. I convened a roundtable in 2018 on the question of automation to explore the options that needed to be looking at, particularly for the figures that we've looked at today. And I do agree with Emma Roddick, it's not a simple thing to do, but it's one we've got to be very ambitious. And I think I'm fully content with the Scottish Labour amendment that really asks the government to be more ambitious around that, because we're in 2022 now, 4 years later. But the roundtable that I conducted brought together local authorities, anti-poverty campaigners, as well as other members, and the then Minister, Jean Freeman, who was also very keen on this idea. And we discussed the automation of benefits like free school meals, school clothing grant, helped to reduce the number of children living in poverty. In Glasgow, which is the authority which I'm Pam Nungan-Glancy represent, has been very, very good on this, and it's definitely worth looking at. 3,500 children were eligible for free school meals, were not registered for them, and they were not accessing this important benefit. And I think that's the situation right across the country. And importantly, as no one's mentioned so far, single parents in particular are one of the groups who don't apply for eligible benefits, just because of the very nature of being a single parent means filling in forums is not the thing that's first on your agenda. So there's many, many reasons why automation of benefits are really important. In fact, Glasgow Financial Inclusion Department talked about when they did the automation of the school clothing grant, that people were phoning up saying, I've got this cheque for £200, I think there's been a mistake. And they say, no, this is money you're entitled to. So you can see the change that that can make to people's lives. Pam Duncan-Glancy is also right to mention the issue of redetermination, another issue that was meant to set apart the Scottish system from Westminster, that we do differently. I confess to the Minister I'm a wee bit out of touch with this, so feel free to intervene in me. But the idea behind this was that we would get it right first time. So we'd see less people having to appeal, and they'd make the appeal system easier for people. If the government can't demonstrate that we've got this right in 2022, I'd like to think you'd put your hand up and say, well, 4 years on, we haven't got that right. I'm happy to take an intervention.
Minister.
For taking an intervention on this point, and again, Pam Duncan-Glancy for raising it, I would just re-emphasise to Parliament that the points Pam Duncan-Glancy made around redeterminations on child disability payments is not a situation that I recognise and not something that's been brought to my attention when I've discussed with my officials on child disability payments. So I think let's all look at this carefully and lay it together.
Polly McNeill.
Well, I'm pleased about that answer, and I'm sure Pam Duncan-Glancy is too, because a lot of time was spent around this provision at the time, and also there's also further provision in there that should you lose your redetermination, all the paperwork for your appeal will automatically be sent to the tribunal. Again, another way of helping people make that application for their appeal. So lots of things that set our social security system aside. But we already know that 104,000 children under six are currently getting the Scottish Child Payment, and we know that given the government's very welcome announcement to extend this, could be an additional 300,000 children could be eligible, and with only 87% uptake of that, we must find why the rest of them are not applying for that benefit. And again, that's why automation of those benefits are really important. The Resolution Foundation suggested that Scottish child poverty, sadly, could rise by 29% by 2023-24. So I think we're all agreed that there's never been a more important time for us to get this right, to make sure that we can do more, to make sure that people have got the benefits that they're entitled to. We've all used the term the cost of living crisis, an innocuous sounding phrase in many ways, with the grim reality behind that lies hungry children, anxious families and mothers going without basic essentials. We can change that. Higher levels of automation would ensure that families would receive the support that they are entitled to. I do welcome the progress that has been made, and I want to say that. But I think 4 years on, I would ask ministers to think very carefully what else can be done. One of the issues is about data sharing, and that's one of the complex areas that I recognise that we must do better. We can do better. It's up to Scottish ministers to be more ambitious and I'm happy to support the Labour amendment tonight.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Could I just remind members who've made an intervention or haven't pressed their buttons and are expecting to speak to check they have pressed their buttons? And with that, Paul McLennan, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As a member of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, I'm delighted to be speaking in the debate this afternoon supporting the Scottish Government motion. It's an important issue that merits the debate this afternoon. As the motion says, the positive impact that the existing automation of Scottish Social Security payments is having is very welcome, including ensuring the most eligible people receive the Child Winter Heating Assistance and Carers Allowance supplement without needing to apply. And we've also heard around about, obviously, it's very welcome the proposal to automate the Best Start Grant Early Learning Payment and the Best Start Grant School Age Payment for eligible families. We just discussed that in the committee a few weeks ago. The Scottish Government also intends continuing exploring opportunities for further automation, and we've heard the Minister talk about that, looking at opportunities to ensure more people get the benefits that they are entitled to, which of course is essentially important at this time of cost of living crisis. The committee again has discussed this with the Minister in detail. Uptake of benefits is also key at this time. The Scottish Government has launched a one-stop shop, the new cost of living website, and we heard Emma Ruddock talk about that earlier on as well. Of course, we have a unique level of support in Scotland, such as the Scottish Child Payment. The Scottish Government also decided to increase eight Scottish benefits by 6% in April 2022, as against 3% by the UK Government. The UK Government has to immediately commit to raising benefits in line with inflation. If they choose not to do so, they will be responsible for pushing 200,000 children into poverty, and that's according to research from a Child Poverty Action Group. The Tory UK Government is more focused on sanctioning rather than supporting people. The number of sanctions issued against universal credit claimants in Scotland has almost doubled in the last 3 years. Doubled. This demonstrates a fundamental issue with the DWP's attitude towards those in low incomes, preventing vulnerable families from receiving the social security that they are entitled to at a time when they need it most. That's a political choice. Natalie Dawn mentioned about the two-child limit and bedroom tax, amongst others. Again, that's a political choice. In comparison, in line with the Scottish Fiscal Commission forecasts, the Scottish Government is committing to £4.2 billion to social security spending, and this will rise to £6.5 billion in 2026-27. This additional spending is needed as a Scottish Child Payment and to fund a different and improved approach between Social Security Scotland's Adult Disability Payment and PIP. And on borrowing powers, Social Security is a demand-led service. We need the ability to react to an increase in demand now. I can understand the Tories' position and not wanting to increase borrowing powers, but Labour, I can't understand their position at all. Not supporting giving more powers to Scotland to tackle issues is a position I can't understand in any way, shape or form. The Child Poverty Action Group sent a briefing for this debate, and very briefly.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
At what point did we mention borrowing powers at all in any of our speeches today?
Paul McLennan.
Not in the speeches today, but you know it's been discussed within committee, and that issue has been raised in committee. Even this morning it was discussed, and Labour wouldn't support that position. I'm really struggling with time, and I know the presiding officer has mentioned that. So, the Child Poverty Action Group sent a briefing for this debate, and they highlighted three key areas. Pauline McNeill obviously mentioned about data sharing, and I think that's key, and it's the first step to automation of low-income Scottish Social Security benefits and other low-income payments, such as those delivered by local authorities. Aligning the eligibility criteria for low-income benefits would make automation and promotion of take-up easier. Again, that has been discussed at committee. And universal payments have higher rates of take-up and have a vital role to play in tackling poverty. So I want to touch on some of these points that CPAG raised today. The importance of data. CPAG welcomed the ambition of the Scottish Government to automate payments to low-income households. They, however, raised the issues of access to data. Stating data sharing is key to automation. And of course, one thing they mentioned as well is it also helps make decisions about spending and resource allocation to target support at those families that most need and support. So I'll maybe ask, I know the Minister we've picked this up with the Minister in committee before, but can I ask you, he picks this up in closing as well. In regard to take-up of Scottish Child Payment, of course, we should be aiming for 100% take-up of the Scottish Child Payment and other low-income benefits. Local authorities have individual household-level data on many low-income families and are already delivering better supports those families on behalf of the Scottish Government. Social Security Scotland have access to DWP and HMRC data to allow for the processing of Scottish Child Payment claims. Data sharing arrangements I know can be complex, but if solutions can be found, this would allow identification of families that may be entitled to additional support such as the Scottish Child Payment and school clothing grants. Now, I know the Scottish Government are looking at this, and I know there is a complex situation around about that. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, CPAG welcomed the commitment in Best Start Bright Futures to bring entitlement of Best Start foods in line with entitlement criteria of Best Start grants and the Scottish Child Payment. This will make automation within Social Security Scotland easier. In committee discussions, members raised the benefits of aligning entitlement criteria for other payments. For example, entitlement of school clothing grants and free school meals could be aligned with the Scottish Child Payment. This will make automation easier, simplify, take up messaging and ensure more. The Scottish Government is unique in its support for the most vulnerable in our society. Automation of existing and future benefits will make take up easier and support even more. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr McLennan. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Alexander Stewart for up to 6 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I join my parliamentary colleagues this afternoon in welcoming the work that has gone into the automation of Scotland's social security payments, the proposals to extend this further, and the acknowledgement that there is more work to do. These payments are vital to the well-being of people across Scotland, both in supporting their day-to-day expenses and at critical times, especially in the lives of young families. I also welcome the work that has been done previously in the development of and over the last year in the implementation of the second benefit take-up strategy. The principles which underpin that strategy are worth reiterating, especially now when the existing challenges of child poverty and COVID recovery have been so heartbreakingly deepened by brutal food price rises, terrifying energy costs, and Westminster policy which swings between incompetence and outright cruelty. Those principles, focusing on real people and their actual needs, speaking and listening with clarity and sensitivity, reaching people where they are, not where we assume we'll find them, cooperating with those working for the same common good, and learning both from successes and mistakes. These are principles we can usefully apply not only to social security, but to all the issues we face as a parliament, a country, and a world. The strategy also identifies barriers to the take-up of social security entitlements. One of those is access, the ways in which that can be so complex, so costly, in terms of time, energy, as well as money, and the process itself acts as a wall instead of a doorway. That is a challenge to policymakers and to systems, and one that can be addressed in part by the automation we are focusing upon today. Another barrier is lack of information, and that too is an issue for those who make and those who implement policy, not just at a national level, but within local government and other agencies, remembering and celebrating the crucial role of the third sector. But it is clear from evidence from other European countries that even with very slick and integrated systems, such as Pam Duncan Glancy and others in the Chamber this afternoon have urged Social Security Scotland to develop, even with these systems, take-up remains below 100%. That is why the final barrier identified in the strategy matters, and it involves us all. The complex, often hidden and deep-rooted social obstacles that still stand between so many people and fulfilment of their rights. The Scottish Campaign on Rights to Social Security, representing key organisations, has written wisely about this, about institutional stigma from official processes, social stigma from the attitudes of others, and self-stigma, a person's own feeling that it is somehow shameful or negative to be receiving what they are entitled to. We know only too well the role that toxic media and poisonous politics have played in creating, extending, and embedding this discourse of shame, of stigma, of othering, and demonisation. We know how it interrelates with other forms of bigotry and prejudice, with other expressions of hate and hostility, not least that of the current Home Secretary just this week towards those seeking the protection of the Refugee Convention, a solemn obligation which it is her particular duty to uphold. It is one of our most serious responsibilities as members of this Parliament to challenge the language of stigma and exclusion and hate. And we have a secondary responsibility as well, to tell different stories based on evidence and experience of why and how social security supports and builds the common good, how it helps to create strong communities, thriving families, and healthy, confident, informed, and compassionate children. Children who are ready to take their place in the society of the future, a future which will need them more than ever before. And I think we have a third responsibility, to think not only about how we talk about those to think not only how we talk about those in or at risk of poverty, but also how we talk about the rich. How does our language, philanthropist, wealth creator, business leader, our concepts of aspiration and success, the speed with which our doors are opened, reinforce hierarchies that are based on money, on privilege, on status, on profoundly ableist conceptions of competence and contribution? In a world where net subsidies to the fossil fuel industry were over $4 billion in 2019, it is not Social Security recipients who are taking more than they give. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I reiterate my welcome for these automation measures and for the ongoing work being done at many levels and in many sectors to improve rates of Social Security take-up. But this is not work only for policymakers, institutions and advice providers, vital though all of these actors are. If we are to build the fair, resilient, compassionate and creative Scotland we long for, we need to dig deep, to uncover and challenge the assumptions we have brought with us, to recognise and celebrate our interdependence. This is a work in progress. We need to keep going, and we need to keep going better. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Carol Mochen for up to 6 minutes. Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I am pleased to be able to contribute to the debate as Scotland continues to develop its own distinct social security system. It remains my hope and the hope of these benches that this journey will result in a distinctly Scottish social security system that is effectively tailored to Scotland's needs. 1 year ago, this Parliament debated this Government's progress on implementing the social security powers as well as the Government's obligation to promote the uptake of these benefits. Since that time, the social security picture in Scotland has continued to develop. Most notably, we now have heard adult disability payments has finally been introduced across all areas of Scotland. While I welcome the nationwide launch of this to be the 12th benefit to be delivered to the Social Security Scotland, it is of course disappointing, Deputy Presiding Officer, that it has taken so long to get to this point. It also remains the case that it will be not until 2025 before this government will finalise taking all the benefits and the powers they have. While Social Security Scotland continues to grow its capacity, it has not been without its problems, Deputy Presiding Officer. The total cost has doubled compared to the original estimates, and administration costs have quadrupled. It is disappointing that benefits, and despite the necessary cost of the agency, it will no longer or will not be any cheaper than the run by the DWP that it is designed to replace. Social Security Scotland also lost nearly £65 billion to fraud and error last year. This is something that cannot be allowed to increase in the scale of the cast that grows significantly in the coming years. Happy to do so.
Minister.
Just for clarity, these points are important. I'm sure the member meant to say 65 million, not 65 billion at that point, recognising the need for us to continue to reduce that figure through diligence.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Minister for my clarification, and that is quite correct. Simply satisfying the service users under. And it's also important that we look at the satisfaction levels that are taking place, because we have seen that there has been a 74% increase in the number of complaints received in the last year alone. With 475,000 cases to administer from the Disability Ability payment alone by 2026, it is also important that the Scottish public receive the services that they rightly expect. I certainly hope that this agency does not face any further problems, because the Social Security Scotland is to succeed. It will ensure that we all benefit across Scotland, and that is vitally important. More generally, several outlookings at the benefits we'll take up remain. For example, the Social Justice and Social Security Committee highlighted the problems of lack of internet access can create, which digital access requires when applying in order to ensure that you get the benefits. This is essential and especially true to older people who are more likely to than other groups live in the remote rural areas where internet access is more likely to be a problem. The issue was made worse by the fact that 1 in 10 people between the age of 65 and 79 are able to use a computer effectively, and that research was carried out by the Citizen Advice Scotland. as with other vulnerable users. It's important that Social Security Scotland continues to engage with older people to ensure that the systems that they are properly tailored to their needs. It should also encourage, as the committee recommended, the increase of access at public places, where that might be a library or a community hub. Of course, automation is particularly key to integrating and increasing the benefits, and we want to see that in the eligibility. In a complex social security system, it remains the case that many families simply can't fully aware and are not fully aware of what they're entitled to. As such, anything that can simplify the process for ensuring payments to those who are entitled to them is to be welcomed. To this end, the automation of payments such as the Best Startup Grant and school-age payments will hopefully provide a significant boost to overall take-up of these benefits. There is no doubt that the automation in certain payments can also have a benefit in areas including processing speed and good value for taxpayers' money. We also need to look at some of the automated elements of universal credit, for example, for this. It remains to be seen, however, whether such automation can be adopted more widely across the Scottish social security system. I would urge the Scottish Government to take an evidence-based approach when assessing how effective this is going to work. Presiding Officer, when it comes to Scotland's social security system, any progress is always to be welcomed, but there is still a long way to go on this journey. With devolved social security spending projected to increase by £2.5 billion by 2027, it is important that we get this right at all levels. Going forward, it is important that Scotland's Government works constructively with the UK Government, and I'm delighted to have heard from the Minister today that that is the case. They want to ensure that there is good dialogue and there is good discussion. It's equally important that we engage with service users to ensure that all benefits are being delivered as effectively as possible. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the coming years will be crucial to getting the system right and ensuring it is something that we all can be proud of, rather than a missed opportunity. To this end, it is much to be looked forward to, and I hope that the success of this journey, and I will continue, as others will, to ensure that this Government delivers the social security system that the Scottish public expect and they deserve. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Stewart. I now call Carol Mochan to be followed by Co-Cab Stewart, again up to 6 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I cannot speak in a debate on social security without highlighting my disgust at the hostile and cruel welfare system that is overseen by the Tories in Westminster. Their treatment of working people, their lack of compassion in helping those most in need, and their intrusive and discriminatory assessments are representative of a government not fit for office. And, Deputy Presiding Officer, I must say the Scottish Conservatives are too responsible for the actions of the UK Government in relation to welfare and social security. The lack of opposition to, and in some cases involvement in, a government that has overseen such brutal cuts to social security is shameless. However, like colleagues have said before, I must stress that we must work across this Parliament to tackle the impacts of the cost of living crisis to ensure more people are not forced into poverty, and to alleviate the pressures facing working families on a daily basis. The ambitions of the Scottish Government to automate payments to low-income households, whether delivered by Social Security Scotland or local authorities, is very welcome. The Scottish Government says it is committed to delivering a transparent social security system and reporting annually on progress, and this is welcome. On the first publication, the Minister, Ben McPherson, said, "We are committed to making sure everyone gets the financial support they are entitled to, and our benefit take-up strategy outlines how we are going to do this. We actively work to encourage take-up of social security benefits by promoting our 12 benefits, collaborating with various organisations and removing barriers to access." And I do appreciate that the Minister wants this to happen, and I have said this in the Chamber before. I don't doubt many of the government backbenchers want this too. But, as we have seen in the debate today, we need to be a little bit more honest about what the movement actually is. And if we are not honest, then how are we going to achieve the outcomes that the Minister and the Government actually want? We must not ignore the fact, Deputy Presiding Officer, that these measures are coming too late, too slowly for many and will not be enough for others. Indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer, we should also not ignore the fact that this is a powerful Parliament. It has the power, but this Government acts with no urgency and seems little ready, or perhaps it's little able, to use those powers. The Scottish Social Security Bill was passed in 2018. We have heard that from across the Chamber. Yet the Scottish Government are not expecting to take over full control of the system from the DWP until the end of 2025. In December 2021, the Scottish Government boasted that 2022 will be the biggest year yet in building a new social security system for Scotland. But now it seems that they have come to the Chamber in this motion with a list of kind of fancy predictions of what the Scottish benefit system will look like. I have acknowledged that they have made some progress. Of course, I acknowledge the benefits of existing automation of Scottish Social Security payments is having, including the, ensuring that the most eligible people receive the child winter heating assistance and carers allowance supplement without needing to apply for it. And I do believe that is a good thing and is very, very welcome, as other speakers have said. But the motion, as is often the case, just seems so self-congratulatory. It needs the Government and the backbenchers to understand that there is some urgency. The system is not even nearly fully automated, and we've heard how important this is if we are actually to lift our communities out of poverty. Take-up of Scottish benefits is not complete. More than 1 in 10 people eligible don't claim the child payment. 1 in 4 people don't claim the young carer grant. 1 in 3 people don't claim their funeral support payment. The Government has not mentioned any plans to automate the benefits for the largest caseload, the Scottish child payment. There is an estimated caseload of 304,000, and there are 353,000 claims for adult disability payments. So by comparison, the numbers of claims that have not been automated, you know, it's just so tiny. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, it's important that we do think critically, both on the opposition benches and on the government benches, because I do believe they want to get better systems in place for people. It's important to note that over three quarters of devolved social security spending is still administered by the Department of Work and Pensions. So, as I mentioned to the member when she took her intervention, this is why the Labour benches are so keen to raise again and again what more can be done, because we want this compassionate system that the government and the backbenchers speak so much about. So, if the Scottish Government does not get a grip and alter the speed of change, child poverty targets will be missed and more children will grow up in poverty. Therefore, although I accept that any additional support for children and their families is welcome, and I have welcomed the child payment before, there is a lot more urgency needed. It's time to keep moving forward, to keep making progress, to be more radical and to end child poverty and support families and those most in use, using the powers you have, all of the powers you have, at all the times that you can. This has to be the aim of this Parliament, and I will continue to hold the Scottish Government to account on this. In concluding, Presiding Officer, I will be the first person to stand up to oppose Tory UK Government cuts to benefits and social security, but it's clear that in Scotland we can do more and we must do more. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. I now call Cocab Stewart, who is the final speaker in the open debate. We will then move to the wind-up speeches, and I would then expect everybody who has participated in the debate to be present. Cocab Stewart, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Social security is itself a human right and essential to the realisation of other human rights. This statement on the face of the 2018 Act affirms the Scottish Government's commitment to develop a benefits system that is accessible, efficient and with dignity, respect and fairness at its core. As we know, there are currently 12 individual benefits delivered by the Scottish Government to people across the country, 7 of them new and unique to Scotland, and all of them vital importance to those in receipt. We also know that the development of Scotland's social security system reflects lived experience of users of the much criticised DWP systems. Having heard of the often callous and distressing way people feel when they are treated when engaging with the DWP, I'm glad that the Scottish Government has taken an entirely different approach to administering and delivering benefits. People are supported at all stages and can request extra support. The application process includes the innovative local delivery service in every council area, which means anyone applying for Scottish benefits can access direct support from an advisor. At the end of last year, over 90% of those responding to the Scottish Government survey described their experience with Social Security Scotland as very good or good. But it is clear that there is work to be done to reach 100% take-up, or close to it as we can get. And key among the means of achieving this is, of course, automation. Automation benefits dramatically improve the experience of eligible people, removing the need for multiple applications. Along with campaigners, I welcome the imminent automation of the Best Start Grant Early Learning Payment and the Best Start Grant School Age Payment. And I urge the Government to move as swiftly as possible to further automate benefits in the interest of increasing uptake. The recent One Parent Family Scotland report, Living Without a Lifeline, acknowledged the importance of the Scottish Child Payment. The increase from £10 to £25 for each eligible child and its extension to all young people up to the age of 16 on 14th of November will be welcomed by one parent families as it will be by all eligible families. Described as a game-changing benefit by John Dickey, Director of Child Poverty Action Group, it is providing essential support at a time when the UK economy is in free fall and making life so difficult for so very many people. It goes without saying that our goal must, of course, be 100% take-up for this benefit. I would ask the Minister in his summing up to confirm whether a further round of invitations to apply will be sent to all families to coincide with the extension of the Scottish Child Payment. Can he also provide any detail on data gathering on behalf of Social Security Scotland to support benefit take-up? I would also ask him to confirm that thresholds for eligibility are reviewed regularly so they keep pace with the reality of income and expenditure. Free school meals and school clothing grant don't lie within the remit of Social Security Scotland. However, it would make great difference to those payments if they could be automated for those in receipt of universal credit and tax credits. I understand that the Cabinet Secretary for Education is already acutely aware of this and is working with the UK Government on the provision of data to progress this, hopefully next year. Moving on, I was pleased to welcome Advice Direct Scotland to Parliament today, supported with Scottish Government funding and based in my constituency of Glasgow Kelvin. They have a powerful benefit calculator on their website where people can check what Scottish benefits they are entitled to, including passported benefits. I commend this calculator to my colleagues and their constituents, and anyone struggling to check their entitlement can phone for friendly and helpful advice. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, Social Security Scotland is a work in progress. It is growing in terms of the number of benefits it delivers, the number of claimants it supports, and the automation it facilitates. It is delivering well for all those who are already engaged with it. Its urgent task is to identify those who are not yet claiming what they are entitled to, and I urge the Government to consider all practical means of achieving this. And I am glad that this motion has been brought so that we can celebrate the successes so far and move the debate forward so that we can improve further. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed. Ms Stewart, we now move to the wind-up speeches. I'm disappointed to note, despite my earlier warning, that there are a couple of colleagues who participated in the debate who are not here. I will expect an explanation for that. I now call Faisal Chowdhury for up to 6 minutes, Mr Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is a pleasure to close this debate for Scottish Labour. Once again, less than 6 months after they last patted themselves on the back over their delivery of social security benefits, we have been presented with another motion of self-congratulation from the Scottish Government. Once again, this motion does not represent the reality on the ground. And once again, the significant points of the caution and the Audit Scotland report on Social Security Scotland go unanswered. My colleague Pam Duncan-Glancy has already noted the apparent lack of priority given to automation of Social Security. Moreover, she has highlighted the amount of benefits still being left administered by the DWP, which is surely nothing to congratulate the Scottish Government for, if the entire point was to do it better themselves. The Scottish Labour amendments highlight many of these ongoing problems left out from the Scottish Government's motion. There are many problems waiting down the line for the delivery of Scottish Social Security benefit, but I want to focus on the so-called agile approach that the Scottish Government is overseeing in its IT system. The theory is that this allows Social Security Scotland to be adaptable, to focus on must-have system for launch before building upon them later. These systems will be crucial for automation to work. But the Audit Scotland report in May made it clear that this approach has trade-offs. It says, and I quote, "For Social Security Scotland to operate efficiently and effectively, resources will be needed over the longer term to continue systems development and replace temporary and manual processes." It continues, "The scale of this is not fully known and will need to be planned for alongside other government priorities." Presiding Officer, this remains a huge step in the dark by the Scottish Government. I'm running out of time, so I've got a lot to go through. What is the agile approach has produced so far is a minimum viable product to onboard the initial social security benefits. As we've heard, it has only automated two so far, and too many still rely on the DWP systems. What we do not know is how easily this can be scaled, how well a scaled-up version will function, or, crucially, how much any of this will cost. We already know that IT costs for Scotland's social security system have already soared to more than 250 million from initial estimated of 39 million. Jeremy Balfour noted this additional cost. When we on these benches raised these questions in May debate, there was no answer from the Scottish Government on any of them. I suspect this is because they do not have those answers. Audit Scotland certainly do not seem to think that they do. The consequence of this is that the Scottish people are being asked to assume much of this purely on faith. We need to again note the looming 760 million black hole in the budget of the Scottish Social Security benefit identified by Audit Scotland. We cannot take on faith alone such a large and important part of the functioning of our social security. The Scottish Labour Amendment also noted the problem with take-up of the devolved benefits. As mentioned by my colleague Pauline McNeill, Pam Duncan-Glancy rightly noted that this could be solved by automation, but has not yet been. The Minister noted in opening that the Scottish Labour amendments engaged in wishful thinking, in suggesting automation had proceeded faster. Yet he also said that the Scottish Government is not quite where we want to be on the take-up of the benefit. Surely this then raises the question of why they have presented us with a motion declaring a job well done. Put simply, it is far too early for the Scottish Government to be congratulating itself on matter of devolved benefit. For this and many other reasons, I commend the Scottish Government, Scottish Labour amendments as a dose of reality. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Miles Briggs. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I think it's important to recognise the context of today's debate and when it's taking place. And I think the Minister did indeed state this at the beginning, because the global cost of living crisis is impacting on the most economically vulnerable individuals and families across the UK. And that is why both of Scotland's governments need to work to help address these pressures and support people through this period. That is why we called for and have supported targeted benefits being delivered by Social Security Scotland. And it is also worth reflecting that to date, £243 billion of support is being delivered by the UK Government and the Scottish Government together to focus direct support for the most vulnerable families in Scotland and across Britain. Yes, very briefly.
Emma Roddick.
I thank the member for allowing me to speak. In the debate on Tuesday, he asked me to welcome one of the measures he's speaking about, £324 to people on tax credits. These have been denied to people with a sanction, 7,342 of which are in Scotland. Does he welcome that?
Miles Briggs.
Well, no, I think that's where there's reviews built into the system to actually look at that, and I think that's important. But what is important is how that system is being reformed in both the UK and here in Scotland. I welcome that, and that's the work in committee I want to take forward as well. But, Presiding Officer, despite the SNP government's motion for today's debate, it must be said that the establishment of Social Security Scotland has not been all plain sailing. As Jeremy Balfour stated, we are all fully aware that SNP ministers have had to hand back administrative roles around many of these payments to the Department for Work and Pensions. And I actually welcome the positive comments which the Minister at committee has often made with regards to the relationship between these two organisations. They have to work together. We must make sure that they succeed in making our welfare system in our United Kingdom and here in Scotland work for everybody. And it is worth reflecting very quickly.
Minister.
Thank the member for taking the intervention. I just urge the member to engage in any correspondence he has with the new DWP ministerial team in Westminster to encourage them to do the same.
Absolutely happy to do that. But it is despite the many promises that we have seen, SNP ministers have not fully put in place our welfare system here in Scotland, which was promised ahead of the 2021 elections. Indeed, Audit Scotland continue to express concern around the challenging timescales regarding delivery of all these new devolved benefits. And as I've stated previously, and I'll state again today, it is in all of our interests to see Social Security Scotland succeed and see that organisation able to deliver efficient and cost-effective assessments and payment systems. And it is the role of opposition parties, I'm sorry to tell SNP ministers, to hold members, to hold ministers to account on this, because we must focus on making sure that the delivery of Social Security Scotland is effective and the outcomes we all want to see are indeed delivered. Now, a few members highlighted some of the issues which I hope the Minister has taken on board. Alexander Stewart made an important point with regards to the digital divide and why maybe people aren't taking up payments available. Pauline McNeill, I think, made an important point with regards to funeral support payments. Why is it, given how we plan and take forward a funeral, that 40% of people entitled to that payment are not taking it up? It is a real issue which I think ministers should have tackled by now. Sharon Derry also stated, as part of her public audit committee work, the case around the government making sure that they are efficiently looking at value for money for the taxpayer. I think that's important. And both Social Justice Committee and also the Finance Committee of this Parliament have raised concerns with the Scottish Government over where currently over the system and data collection is not fully in place. Faisal Chowdhury said, and I think this is important, around projected costs for Social Security Scotland and delivering our welfare system. They stand today at over £290 million. Now, that equates to 10% of total resources to deliver the payments, compared to 6% for the Department of Work and Pensions. Now, I know there is a projection for that to come in line, but we have had no data or opportunity to really see where we are and where that is on track, and I hope it is on track. I know from discussions with Social Security Scotland that that is a projection, but it's also something we need to make sure ministers are held to account. Today's debate is also an important opportunity, I think, to highlight the need for greater transparency, and that's something all committees of this Parliament are asking for and highlighting. Audit Scotland state that implementation costs regarding the new devolved benefits have not been routinely reported on in the public domain, and I think that needs to change, and change quickly. That makes it impossible, if not difficult, for proper scrutiny, which all of us want to make sure takes place. In terms of some of the points which had been raised earlier as well, Social Security Scotland, the Minister has highlighted 90% satisfaction. That was as the benefit system has been rolled out. As we see more benefits being rolled out, I think it is concerning to note that client complaints have increased by 74% in the space of 1 year. Now, I note what the Minister said with regards to looking at the appeal system and redeterminations, and I welcome that. I think that's important for us to really make sure why is it we're seeing rapid increases in complaints around Social Security Scotland. That's something all of us want to see addressed. The Scottish Government needs to make clear that its long-term vision for Social Security Scotland, what that is, and lay out practical steps that it's taking to make sure that the body is more transparent and accessible to the public on the delivery of this new system. Finally, Presiding Officer, I think one thing this debate has also brought forward, when members are raising independence and what they want to see, is there is a key financial part of our Scottish public finances which no SNP member can get away from, and that is simply two words, and that is the Barnett formula. There is £8.5 billion of Scottish taxpayers' money we are spending because of the Barnett formula. I welcome that. I think it's an important part of redistribution. But ministers and members of the SNP and Green parties cannot simply wish that away. It's the size of the NHS budget in Scotland. Independence would leave that £8.5 billion black hole, and honesty is something we need to hear from SNP and Green members over what would be cut. One of the key things today's debate has brought is the future, and this week's announcements is the future around our public finances. We need to make sure we're all working together to deliver Social Security Scotland and these payments for the people who desperately need it. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Ben McPherson to wind up. 9 minutes or so, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and to colleagues for an important debate in these serious times. And I think Sharon Dowie, who made a very thoughtful and the majority fair contribution, I thought made an important point at the beginning of her remarks, where she said it is in the interests of all parties to support Social Security Scotland and for us to work together in the service of our constituents to make sure that this service delivers for people, and particularly at this time. Some important points were raised by Pauline McNeill and others around data sharing, and I can just confirm that we continue to work with many parties, local authorities, the DWP and the HMRC to improve data sharing, increase take-up, and that extends to our work on automation as well, and we'll continue to do so in this time ahead. CoCab Stewart asked me some particular questions regarding thresholds. We do continue to keep them under review. And with regard to the fact that when the Scottish Child Payment is extended and uplifted, we will indeed be both text messaging and emailing all current claimants to make them aware of the extra support that is available. And that is demonstrative of the practical work and proactive work that I set out in my opening statement and others have set out today that is underway in terms of promoting benefits in our communities. And the Scottish Government, of course, rightly and indeed in the 2018 Act, is obligated to take a lead in that. And Beatrice Wishart raised a question around what specific engagement is the Scottish Government undertaking to promote benefits. And I laid out in my opening remarks around the 12 paid-for marketing campaigns that have been undertaken since October 2021 with a range of channels, considering digital exclusion to promote our benefits on television, through the radio, print and digital as well. And you know, for example, when adult disability payment was launched across Scotland at the end of August, you know, there were 8 pieces of broadcast television and radio coverage across national and regional channels and 44 pieces of print and online, as well as individual engagement by organisations and MSPs to promote the benefits. Yes.
Miles Briggs.
I wondered what work had been done specifically with regards to funeral payments, given the system, given how you plan, that 40% of people aren't looking at taking forward that.
Minister.
Important point, and what's encouraging is that the amount of support that people are getting through funeral support payment is much higher than it was under the previous UK benefit, and there is a lot of engagement with providers and relevant support organisations to encourage people to uptake that support. There is evaluative work going on as we speak based on the estimates that they were published on Monday, and that is the data that COCAB Stewart talked about being so useful. The fact that we now have this estimated data as was published on Monday for the first time helps us in that analysis, and I'm happy to engage more with Mr Briggs because he's right that we want to get the level of uptake for funeral support payment to a much higher level. I can confirm to Jeremy Balfour that we are in around 150 GP practices across Scotland, so that is happening, and I'm happy to pick that up further with him if he would like more details. On some of the wider points that were raised and the thematic issues that matter to us all, you know, there's been a lot of discussion today. Alexander Stewart said that we want Social Security Scotland to be something that we can all be proud of. I am proud of Social Security Scotland. It's not perfect, but what it's achieved in its short existence since 2018 in terms of the thousands and thousands of people that it's helped and the way it's developed with 21st century infrastructure and a proactive approach based on the values that we agreed as a Parliament is something to be proud of. And that's why I find it so deeply unhelpful for members, especially one as well-informed and well-intentioned as Jeremy Balfour, to call Social Security Scotland a mess. That's such an unjust characterisation of this organisation that is helping people every single day and populated by such well-motivated people.
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm grateful to the Minister. I don't generally believe I ever use those words in my speech. My point was that due to the Scottish Government, nothing to do with the agency, there have been major delays in delivering these benefits. But I think, you know, please correct the record, I did never call the agency a mess.
Minister.
The process of rolling out our delivery of devolved Scottish benefits and Social Security Scotland being that delivery agency are part of the same equation. And that's why, you know, opposition members are absolutely right, of course, to hold the government to account. But when we're doing things well in Scotland, let's be honest about the challenges, but also honest about the achievements and about how that makes a difference for all the constituents that we serve. Because it is a success story. I mean, Faisal Chowdhury raised the point around IT costs, but then also spoke in the sentences following that about how he wanted to see more expenditure. And we have to get a degree of consistency and fair analysis when it comes to this question, because this is an agency that is at the beginning of its development, but it's going to be a really important organisation for delivering for all of our constituents, particularly this year and compared to years past, but then also in the decades ahead. And we are lending we are investing and establishing really firm and effective foundations to do that. And, you know, Presiding Officer, when Carl Mochan and other Labour members talk about a sense of urgency, I can tell you that there's a deep sense of urgency within the ministerial team and within the civil service to do this as quickly as possible, but also a sense of responsibility to do it right and to make sure it's done in an effective way, not just for the short term, but to future-proof the service as well. And it is a very successful delivery organisation. And for the Labour Party to just criticise the SNP, who, as I mentioned, are responsible for gaining the powers over social security here in Scotland, for the Labour Party to say, oh, you've not done very much and it's just backpatting, I'm sorry, I won't take that, because, you know, there are around 25,000 children here in Scotland who are getting £200 through our Child Winter Heating Assistance. There's a Scottish Child Payment that's helping people now. Was £10 a week, now £20 a week, going to be £25 a week from the 14th of November. And we've had a bridging payment effective rollout to 140,000 households. You know, this is a significant amount of investment that is helping people day in, day out in our constituencies. By the end of 2022, our five family payments could be worth up to £10,000 by the first child turns six, and up to £9,700 for subsequent children. That is significant difference and investment in our communities. And, you know, don't talk that down as if it's something that's not a remarkable achievement. £460 million going to households above the block grant adjustment, more than in any other part of the UK. So, you know, let's be really, really serious about this. Presiding Officer, we have done remarkable things with the powers we have. We've got a lot more to do. And we need, on all parts of this, these benches, to be thoughtful and realistic about the lessons from Social Security Scotland about how taking the right time to do things correctly enables good delivery. And this is an example of that we can take learning from and we can take confidence from. I will end on what I hope is a point of consensus, because I hope everybody votes for this motion, because I've drafted it in a way to be consensual. Because we all have a responsibility, whether it's through cost of living events in our constituencies, the social media that we engage in, the communications from our political parties, how we share things in our communities, to get the word out. Because the Scottish Government is being proactive and showing leadership on driving benefit take-up and on increasing automation, but we all have a role to play. And on the 14th of November, which is coming very soon, when the Scottish Child Payment is extended to under-16s, and goes up to £25 a week, I want to see every single MSP in this chamber taking responsibility to amplify that in their communities. Yeah. Because that's what working together is all about. That's what making a difference is all about. And that's what this government is absolutely focused on. I close the debate and ask members to support the motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on progress on the automation and take-up of Scottish Social Security benefits. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, and there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that Amendment 6572.1 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, which seeks to amend Motion 6572 in the name of Ben McPherson on progress on the automation and take-up of Scottish Social Security benefits, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote. There'll be a short suspension to allow members to access digital voting.